So welcome. My name is John Morrison, and I'm from University College Cork. I'm coordinating a Horizon 2020 project called Cloud Lightning, which is looking at hyperscale clouds, basically, and cloud management for various reasons, for the next generation of cloud. We have a lot to say. We're kind of 2.5 years or so into the project, so we're kind of coming to the downward slope. We have a lot done. You'll hear some more about it this morning from Costas, a colleague from Greece. We'll be talking about some simulations. But I wanted to give you kind of a flavor of the project from one particular perspective. I didn't want to give you kind of a project overview. I wanted to kind of tune the project to the presentation, the title of the session, which basically, if I remember right, is Next Generation Resource Management. So we came up with that really to sort of suit our own purposes, because we think there's going to be next generation resource management for cloud, and I'll tell you why. So myself and Wanwan put these together, these slides together. So Wanwan is a senior postdoc. So what I want to talk about is cloud resource management, just to refresh your memory what that actually means in current day clouds. And then to say a few words about the fact that the cloud isn't what it used to be. The cloud is changing, the cloud is evolving, and that evolution is bringing about quite a number of changes, or is requiring a number of changes of us, so that evolution can proceed. So I'm going to look then at addressing those changes and a mechanism for wrestling with the complexity that those changes are bringing about. I'm going to talk a little bit about self-organization and self-management and applying those principles to resource management. And then I'll finish with some final remarks. So resource management at the moment, traditional resource management in the cloud, here, what I'm talking about for my talk, I'm going to confine resource management to one very specific type, or one very specific part, and that's resource allocation. It's also called resource scheduling. Other aspects like resource lifecycle management, I'm not going to consider. So we're interested here in trying to identify or try to explore the mechanisms that current cloud uses, providers use, in identifying resources for executing tasks within the cloud. How do you determine which resource? How do you identify it? How do you select it? Now this is not an easy, or it's not a very transparent thing. There are many, many proprietary schemes from Google, Amazon, Azure, etc. They're not disclosed. They don't tell us how they do this. So the work that I'm going to present here is based upon what we do know, what's in the open, that's open source, and it's the best known version of that is open source. So we'll say a few words about that, just to set the scene of how things are done. Okay. Within OpenStack, the system uses a special service known as the Nova Scheduler, to locate resources to host the next task. And in doing that, the scheduler has the ability to apply different types of strategies. This is a very powerful system. You can do things like a chance scheduler, where you can just choose the next host randomly. So a task comes in, the cloud provider says, where do I provision this virtual machine? Well, that'll do. I'll just choose the next host. You can go for a simple scheduler, choosing a host based on the number of running cores. So the host with the least number of running cores, I'll choose that one, and therefore I'll bin pack in that one. Or I can go for something more sophisticated and look at filter scheduling. So filter scheduling then is an effort to try to match a number of criteria, the application criteria and the machine criteria together. And in doing that, then, the filter comes from the fact that there's a resource pool. They're filtered out based on some criteria, and then there's a with the remaining ones, there's a weighted sum applied to the remaining ones, and then the one with the least cost is chosen. Okay, so it's a sophisticated algorithm, and you can gather from the just my explanation of it that there's a lot involved in doing it. Right, so you have a number of hosts, these are candidate hosts, these are possible hosts. And don't forget that we're not talking about six, right? We're talking about tens of thousands of possible hosts, typically in a large data center that can be used to host the next task. You filter those out, depending on which ones would best suit the needs of the application. So the VM that you need to deploy has to have so much memory, that excludes a couple. It has to have a particular network bandwidth, etc. So filters out a few more, etc. And then after filtering, these hosts are sorted after weighing after applying some kind of weights. Right? I'll talk about this in a little bit more detail. And then those weights are effectively like the cost function, but they're the cost function from the perspective of the provider. Provider is saying, you know, it costs me this much or that much, etc., to do the following things. Now, these weights can actually be applied as well by the user of the system, by the person deploying the VM. Now, there are more than 20 filters currently available. They can be combined to meet complex requirements. So these filters then can be composed. So then you have filters on filters, etc. So therefore, again, what I'm trying to get across to you is this is not a trivial process, right? So you have resource-based filters, decisions made according to which available resources are there, how much memory you have, how much disk, how many CPU cores, etc. And there are examples of a core filter, a disk filter, RAM filter. There's image-based filters made, these filters, filter machines according to available image properties. You have host-based filters. These are decisions here made according to the grouping criteria, where's the location of the individual hosts. Availability zones refer to geographical areas where these hosts may be. And these hosts may be designated for a particular type of use. So you can filter on that. You have network-based filters, and you have custom filters that can be defined by the user. So the user can come along, write a bit of JSON, and then as a result of that, define a filter, and that filter then will be applied. So, complex process. Lots of machines, complex process. In terms of the weighting, the least cost algorithm is used in OpenStack. Schedules instance creation on available hosts in the order of the weight assigned to each host. So the input to a set of object is a set of objective functions called cost functions. These cost functions consider four parameters: CPU, RAM, disk, storage, and memory. And then for each host, for each function, there's a weighted sum calculated. And after that weighted sum has been calculated, the host with the least cost is chosen. Okay? So you could say, for example, that the preference wants to, you want to give preference to the machines with the most RAM, so that the weight here would be a 1, and you want to give no preference to, it could be minus 1 because it's the least weight. You want to give no preference to the CPU. I don't know why you would do that, but then you would have a weight of 1, and then that's kind of, after the weighted average, it sort of falls out of the system. So then you can then put the emphasis on the actual type of resources that you want to have in that machine. Now all of this then is kind of built up in the scheduler. The scheduler applies all of these. Again, scheduler, to my ears, is the wrong word, you know, because scheduling is to do with time. Okay, but these are the words that are used. So the scheduler selects a host, applies a cost function, And then it simulates the effect of that cost of deploying the resource on that machine before it goes and iterates to take the next task. Okay? So if you want to allocate a number of resources simultaneously, it's done iteratively. So there's a kind of a cumulative application of the scheduler and cumulatively building up the cost and the effect on each host. At the end of the process, you end up with a sorted list of hosts, and you choose the one with the least cost. All these costs are, of course, normalized. So that they can be compared. So if we look at these then, this is the traditional system. So the summary of these characteristics in the OpenStack filter staging strategy then, these are sophisticated strategies. It doesn't take a lot of thought to suggest that scheduling time is going to increase with the filter complexity. The more you have to filter, the longer it's going to take. Scheduling time is going to increase with the host population size. The more hosts that you're considering, then the slower it's going to be. Okay. As I said, filtering operations are determined by the application. Weights are pre-configured into the scheduler and thus statically determine its behavior. So once you make an OpenStack deployment, you configure those weights into the scheduler and you forget about it. That's your OpenStack deployment. That is your strategy built into the system. Now, so we see two problems there, right? We see a static sort of scheduling strategy that initially reflects your operational needs. We see filtering that is there's a little bit of dynamicity there because it's applied at the application level, so that's good. But then we see this bottleneck at scale. So that when the host population size increases, when the filter complexity size increases, you'll get to a point where you can't do that type of scheduling. And if you can't do that type of scheduling, then your resources are not going to be well used. You're not going to be able to determine a priori before you deploy whether or not this is a good decision. That's where we're starting from. So let's keep that in mind. Put a pin in that. We'll think about that for a minute. So we said, well, what's the problem, John? That's great, it works, you know, OpenStack is there, it's doing its job. But yeah, fine. But the cloud isn't what it used to be, and probably never will be again. It's changing. It's becoming a victim of its own success, right? The cloud is growing in complexity, in size. Complexity and costs are rising. There's low server utilization, possibly because of the fact that more and more machines, the filter scheduling doesn't work very well. Over-provisioning is rampant because quality of service is a huge issue. There's high energy costs overall, which is unsustainable. More diverse and complex applications are being created all the time that need to be served or need to be hosted. Heterogeneous resources are emerging everywhere. We have the Intel many integrated cores, we have FPGAs running data flow engines, we've got GPUs, we've got a whole zoo of heterogeneous resources that are wonderful at reducing energy costs, increasing sort of decreasing the computation per watt cost, etc. And control theory, on top of all of that, says, you know, centralized management is going to be ineffective at scale. You can't manage something if it's not close to you, right? As something becomes big and distributed, you have to gather information about that thing. Once you gather the information, it takes time. As soon as you gather the information, that thing has changed. You make a decision based on something that's already. That's the problem. So the next generation of resource management has to actually contend with that type of thing. How is that going to be? Now, on top of that, there's some perceived objectives, the customer level objectives. We want to make cloud computing more accessible, make it more efficient, move towards ease of everything so that it's democratized, people can use it. There are provider level objectives. The provider needs to reestablish control over their hardware, over their IS offering. They need to be able to win back the management of their resources. Presently, if they sell the resources to the end user doesn't care about power consumption. The end user just uses the resources. So for better power management, there has to be somebody responsible. That person should be the provider. And they want to enable faster provisioning, better business models, etc. And we want to enable seamless exploitation of hardware resources, exploit faster, cheaper service delivery, and exploit heterogeneous hardware types for different services and different implications of the same service. That brings us on to this idea of self-organization. Why self-organization, self-management? Not for its own sake, right? A lot of people say, okay, there you're taking a buzzword, you're applying it, maybe. You know, I'll take that. But there's a reason. Because self-organization is a tool. Self-organization, self-management is a tool for handling complexity. It's only one tool for handling complexity, but it is a good tool for handling complexity. We see examples of it everywhere. So why not try? Why not try to use that as a realistic tool? Now, self-organization, self-management really requires us to put some kind of structure on the system. If the system is to manage itself, an inherent part of a self-managing, self-organizing system is that it's contained within a structure and it develops within that structure. Structure is evolved. Okay? So we need to sort of identify that structure, that architecture that would embody that ability to evolve and to change. So it's a very important thing to define an architecture which allows the cloud to evolve and to change. Typically, our current cloud systems are very flat in that regard. Our resource fabric is flat. Okay, so we can bring structure to that fabric, and that will help us with the reorganization effort. In addition, we need to be able to make decisions that are independent or that are agnostic to the underlying types of resources that are there. So one of the things we decided that we tried to do is we tried to develop a kind of a generic idea of what a resource is. We defined it as a CL resource, it's just a name that can stand for any type of resource. And we identified different types of resources, traditional CPU, commodity CPUs, or CPU-GPU combinations, or CPU mix, or data flow engines. In fact, we could see a whole HPC subsystem as being a resource, a single resource. And all of these resources then, from our self-organizing and self-managing system perspective, is just a single node. It's just a resource. Now, these resources have different characteristics, which mean that they've been managed in different ways. However, at one level in the reorganization, in the organization, they're all equal. So in terms of the structure, if we want to move towards a dynamic filtering mechanism, this is the line, or this is the attack that I'm taking up on a project description at the moment. There's only one way of describing it. So we want to move towards this dynamic filtering mechanism and this dynamic weighted filtering mechanism. We want to look at facilitating scalability with increasing host population size and filtering complexity. So these two things increase, we get better scalability. So one of the first things we'll do is we look at hierarchically structuring our host space to reflect host properties. So in our host space, as we break it up, we'll break it up according to hardware type. So different hardware types would be in different parts of that space. So we have heterogeneous cloud, but each part of the space will be homogeneous. We may say that we can break up part of the space so that resources that are co-located on low latency networks are kept together. So therefore, if we want to deploy HPC-like applications on that part of the environment, we can identify it. We've embodied it in that type of resource, in a description of that resource. We've captured the characteristics of the low latency. We might have proximity to storage servers, etc., etc. And we want to move towards a decentralized resource management decisions. So, two things: hierarchically structured, split the space, and decentralize the decisions. Okay. So our kind of take on that then gave us this type of architecture here. In layer zero, we have the heterogeneous resource fabric. Basically, everything is there as a flat pool. And then we can aggregate homogeneous subsets of resources here into what we call VRAC managers. So this manager manages this subset, this manager manages the subset, manages a subset. But all of these managers are managing resources of the same type. I know they're of the same type because they're under the same pgroup. Okay? P-switch enables me to have a finite number of managers. Okay? And if I can actually replicate the switch, I can have a number of switches so that the load of the management load of managing this number of managers doesn't become, or a big number of managers doesn't become too great. I can split the load across two switches. But the pruters themselves identify different heterogeneous branches. So down here, I have the resources of a particular type, okay? And maybe GPUs, accelerators. Here, we might have just simple commodity servers, etc. And we can have as many of those as we wish. Okay, so that's a very simple representation of the system that we're in. Resource requests then travel down through here. The resource is identified, the resource is returned, and then the deployment mechanism takes over, and then that resource is utilized. Okay? But there are many decisions that can be taken as we go down through this tree. So how do you make those decisions? Okay? Entities in the same layer self-managed. So all of these things, they manage themselves. In each layer, they're all managing themselves. Moreover, under certain constraints, they're able to transfer management of lower level components and to self, and in doing so, they self-organize. So if we say here, this P-switch could transfer the management of that VRM to that P-switch. So therefore, this part of the system now looks very different than before. So the system can change and dynamically reconfigure itself so that what's below looks different. Similarly here, the resources that are being managed by this manager can be exchanged and can be transferred, can be shared, you know, moved over and be managed by this manager. And the rules for doing that then gives us the whole self-organizing strategy, which I won't go into now. The reorganizing strategies, though, are designed to maximize the functional requirements of the application and the non-functional requirements of the system. So we have two things, right? And the traditional management framework itself, or the traditional cloud framework, looks really at the functional requirements of the system and really ignores the non-functional requirements, the power consumption, the quality of service, the management costs, all of these types of things. So we're looking at maximizing those two things. I have to speed up. The chair is falling on the job. There are different groupings that we can look at. I won't go into that in detail. I'll keep on message for a while. The next step in trying to dynamically create this filtering mechanism, in addition to this structuring and decentralized management, is to dynamically calculate a thickness view, which we call a perception, per locale in that architecture, and to propagate that thickness view upwards. We dynamically calculate a driving force as well, per locale, and we propagate that driving force downwards. Okay? And then we combine that driving force downwards with a view from upwards to calculate what we call a suitability index at each locale. That suitability index is an indication of how suitable this region is to accept the next task. That's our big goal. And what we do, because we have a suitability index at each node in the tree, is we maximize the suitability index everywhere. By maximizing the suitability index everywhere, we allow the system as a whole to adopt some kind of stasis. So, in doing that, as I said, the task will come in. The task is trying to navigate towards a set of resources that will be the right resources to execute that task. At the bottom level, the hardware resources are, we have a number of assessment functions that are capturing the non-functional requirements like the energy consumption, etc. These are weighted assessment functions. Those weights are propagated down from the top dynamically, and effectively those weights reflect the organizational desires of the or the business rules of the cloud provider. The cloud provider says, I want to give priority to speed, and I don't care about energy. So they can propagate those weights down. And then as those weights become associated with the assessment functions at the end, the perception that's created by those assessment functions will create a fitness. And that fitness then will say, oh, these resources are the best ones to give you computational power and ignoring efficiency, energy efficiency. In this part of the system over here, we can have a different propagation. So this propagation of weights down is like a directed evolution where we tell the system, evolve in this way, please. Now, as these impetuses come down, they can be changed along the way. They can be attenuated, or they can be updated, or they can be slowed down. The effect on the lower end of the system can be changed. This is all parameterizable. The perception that's created then flows up, and that perception, together with the impetus, determines the suitability. So as a resource comes, as a task request comes in, depending on what's available below, which is determined here, the functional requirements, I have so much memory, I have so much CPUs, etc., being propagated up and aggregated. That aggregation tells us that in this region, we have so many resources of a particular type. This tells us the fitness of choosing those types to maximize the overall goals of the system. So the impetus is a vehicle for directed evolution. This suitability index embodies the non-functional requirements. Routing both maximizes the functional requirements of the application and the non-functional requirements of the system. And it allows for resource selection without reservation. And that's a very common feature of the decentralized selection algorithms. Normally, if you decentralize the selection algorithm, you have some kind of bidding mechanism, some kind of market-oriented algorithms. And you have resources that are tied up until the decision is made. Here, we just use this single metric to go to where the resource will be the best, where we think will be the best. It may not be the best. And if we get to that point, we send our task to a particular point, and we say, actually, we don't have the resources here that we need, then reorganization will kick in. The reorganization at that level will provide the resources that are needed. We're very confident that that will be the case because of the value of the suitability. And our simulations are showing that to be true. Okay, we can boot the cloud. It's a novelty. We can boot the cloud by adding resources to the cloud through the cell manager, and just as tasks move through the hierarchy in search of a resource, we can get the resource script, the resource itself, and the resource identifier to navigate through the hierarchy and to position itself in the place where it's going to be most useful. Again, using the same suitability index. So we can build the cloud in a kind of a plug-and-play mechanism using that navigation. So what we're looking for is we have constructed a way of doing decentralized resource management that doesn't involve reservation. It embodies scalability, so it allows us to do sophisticated filtering and resource selection that's not confined by the host population size and the complexity of the filter. And as a result, we are able to separate the concerns of the application and the underlying service provider. We give the service provider control back over the resources again. And we're creating a service-oriented cloud for the emerging heterogeneous cloud. We're giving the IS operator, the cloud operator, control over the consumption of energy. We've improved service delivery, leveraging heterogeneity. And in fact, by defining our resources as HPC subsystems, we can use the cloud to deploy to those subsystems. And in fact, by targeting tasks at resources that are co-located on low latency networks, we can dynamically create HPC systems. So I'm not going to say any more than that, just say that's